Hello, everyone, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Kelsey Kamen, and I am the program coordinator for NCWIT Counselors for Computing. It's my pleasure to bring you the final episode of this six-part series hosted by NCWIT Counselors for Computing. Each month through July, we've connected you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. The series offers a unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as CS+X. Throughout the presentation, we would love for you to submit questions through the Q&A feature on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. And we'll also be sharing resources in the chat, which is also found on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. The National Center for Women in Information Technology, or NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,400 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women in computing existed mostly in isolation, without the benefit of shared best practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. So today, these programs are part of the NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. And Counselors for Computing, or C4C, is one of the programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. NCWIT Counselors for Computing, or C4C, program provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. And we wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists, engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships and scholarships for students, and many career development opportunities for educators. We've shared their website in the chat for you to learn more. So I would now like to introduce our three speakers today, Caeley, Aly, and Rachel. Caeley Looney is a total space geek and avid Netflix binger and French fry lover. Her Twitter tagline reads rocket scientist by day and editor in chief by night, as she does exactly that. Having graduated from Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University with a BS with a Bachelor's of Science in Aerospace Engineering in 2018, she now works full-time as a mission analyst for L3Harris Technologies, where she supports their small satellite programs. Once the workday is over, she comes home and works on Reinvented magazine. So as a founder and CEO of this 501c3 nonprofit organization, Caeley works to empower young girls to pursue STEM fields through the creation of the nation's first ever print magazine written for girls in STEM. Outside of work and running a nonprofit, Caeley is continuing to advance her education by pursuing her master's in science in space systems engineering part-time at Johns Hopkins University Online. On a less professional note, Caeley spends most of her free time running distances most people call crazy, knitting, and going on long walks on the beach with her dogs. Aly Trevino is a graduate from the University of Texas at San Antonio with a Bachelor of Arts in Multidisciplinary Studies, with concentrations in neuroscience, psychology, and education. She conducted research in a neurobiology lab focused on memory and aging and has presented her research at various STEM conferences. Through presenting, she found her passion for empowering young women to pursue STEM fields. Currently, she is a volunteer with Reinvented magazine as co-chief operating officer. And Rachel Weeks is an engineer by day and a STEM advocate by night. She is a systems test engineer for rocket launch company, United Launch Alliance, where she works on the payloads team and prepares satellites for their trips to space. When she's not working as a rocket scientist, Rachel volunteers her time as the chief development officer for Reinvented magazine. She received her bachelor's degree in aerospace engineering from Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University in 2018, and her master's degree in space systems engineering from Johns Hopkins University in 2021. In her free time, Rachel enjoys playing tennis, drawing, and running. Thank you so much, ladies, and I would now like to present to you the pre-recorded presentation from our Reinvented magazine board members.
Hi, everyone. My name is Caeley Looney, and I'm a mission analyst at L3Harris Technologies and CEO at Reinvented magazine.
Hey, everyone. My name is Rachel Weeks. I am a systems test engineer at United Launch Alliance, also known as ULA, and I'm the chief development officer at Reinvented magazine.
Hi, my name is Aly Trevino, and I am a former researcher and chief operating officer at Reinvented magazine. So how did I get here? So I used to do research for the SEMA LSAT program through the Alamo Colleges, but it took me a really long path to kind of get there. So when I first graduated high school, I thought I wanted to pursue an education degree and become a teacher like my mom. But once I got to university at Texas Women's, I really didn't like the classes. I just had a really hard time adjusting, and just teaching really wasn't for me. But I did find my sorority, Tri Sigma, and I will get back to that in just a minute and how that is an important part of my journey. So once I realized education really wasn't my path, I decided to move back home and start at the local community colleges in San Antonio, the Alamo Colleges, and there I received an Associate of Science and Associate of Liberal Arts. While I was there, I participated in the SEMA LSAT program, and I got to do neuroscience research in a neuroscience lab at the University of Texas at San Antonio. My research focused on memory loss diseases, so like Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, diseases like that. And in 2019, I received my bachelor's in multidisciplinary studies with concentrations in neurobiology, psychology, and education. So why pursue neuroscience research? Because the brain is amazing and there's so much to learn. So as I mentioned before, my project was focused on memory loss diseases. My project title specifically was The Effect of Methylene Blue on Associative Learning in C. elegans. And to really put it simply in one sentence, I looked at microscopic worms, and that's it. That's all I did. And I was testing methylene blue, which is a really common reagent in the lab. And yeah, I had a really great time. I had a ton of different opportunities. I got to present my research at all kinds of different conferences, local and national. And yeah, as you can see on my slide there, that was one of my first conferences at the Women Breaking Through STEM, where I got to present my research to over 150 girls at middle school and high school. So in my research program, like I mentioned, I got to attend a ton of different conferences. I got to go to AmberCams and SACNAS, and those are two really big national science conferences. It really opened up a lot of doors and networking opportunities that eventually led me to Reinvented, which ergo through Sigma, I was really lucky to find Rachel, who posted a little ad in our alumni group, and that is how I ended up in Reinvented.
Okay, it looks like it's my turn now. So like I said before, my name is Rachel Weeks, and I will be telling you about my STEM journey today. So just like Aly, I kind of really didn't see myself pursuing engineering at first. When I was in high school, I did take a lot of advanced placement classes, but I was never really interested in any topics like robotics or computer science. I was always more interested more in like hanging out with my friends, playing tennis, or even singing in my school's choir. Although I was really good at math and physics, my main academic passion was the subject that most engineers tend to hate, which is English and writing. I was a total bookworm in high school, and I loved analyzing books. Give me Shakespeare, I could analyze it for days. Because of my passion for writing, I originally wanted to study English in college. So I was torn. I was given these really great talents in math and science, and I really didn't want them to go to waste, but I did want to study English. Ultimately, I started talking to my English teacher, and she told me that, you know, engineering is not all about math and science. In order to be an engineer, you do have to, you know, write procedures, write documents, give presentations, everything like that. So she told me, you know, why not do both and become an engineer? You can have the best of both worlds and combine your love for English and combine that with your love for math and science. So that's exactly what I decided to do. So at that point in time, I had to decide what kind of engineer I wanted to be. Growing up, I used to always watch the shuttle launches from my backyard, and I loved reading about sci-fi books and about space exploration. This convinced me to study aerospace engineering at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University in Daytona Beach, which is how I met Caeley, but I'm sure she'll talk about that later. This journey definitely wasn't a walk in the park, but I made it through my bachelor's degree. And then I must have really liked, you know, studying space because I decided to get my master's degree in space systems engineering. If you know anything about Embry-Riddle, it is a very male-dominated school, and it's only about 20% women. And I was able to get through that journey because I was able to surround myself with very empowered women who are also studying engineering as well. And they helped me become the woman that I am today. And like you can see right here in this picture, I have my Tri Sigma letters, which is exactly how Aly said we met through Tri Sigma. So I am a systems test engineer for a launch company called United Launch Alliance. So basically I work for the payloads team, and we describe everything as taking the satellite and kind of wrapping up in a package and presenting it onto the rocket so then it's ready for launch. The best part about this is it's so much fun getting to work with different organizations like the Air Force and NASA, and then companies like Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman, because we get to launch these satellites that will protect our country and also help us explore the galaxy. I've worked on about 10 missions so far, and my favorite one so far has been Mars 2020, which is the launch of the NASA's Perseverance rover. It's been amazing watching the rover's journey on Mars and knowing that I helped to get it there.
All right, so hi everyone. Like I said on the first slide, my name is Caeley Looney, and I'm the founder and CEO of Reinvented. However, that's pretty much my side hustle since I work full-time as a space mission analyst at L3 Harris Technologies. I'll talk a little bit about my journey to becoming an aerospace engineer, and then also tell you a little bit about what Reinvented Inc. actually is now that you've met most of my core leadership team. So my journey started way, way back. I was one of the luckiest girls growing up because I was the daughter of not one, but two engineers. My dad originally designed fighter jets for the Navy and then for Northrop Grumman, and my mom made up the other half of his dynamic aerospace duo because she designed the aircraft carriers that they landed on for the Navy. So my house was constantly full of cool aircraft schematics and huge boats, and then there was me, a girl who wanted to be a fashion designer when I grew up. But as you can see from those mustache suspenders, that probably was not the best career path for me. And you might be thinking, oh, well, that's just a costume or something. Nope, I promise you, I dress like that all the time, and not just for competitions. So in sixth grade, when I first was starting to get exposed to STEM and absolutely hating it, my mom dragged me to this meeting at a local Girl Scout Council for FIRST Robotics. She assured me that if I still hated it after I got there, we could just leave and never talk about robots again. But she was completely in for it, because after that meeting, I pretty much never stopped talking about robots again. It was through robotics that my passion for tech and engineering first sparked, and then in my senior year of high school, I ended up winning NCWIT's Aspirations in Computing Award in New York City, and that was pretty much the cherry on top. It solidified my decision to go to school to study engineering, specifically for aerospace. And so that's exactly what I did. In August 2014, I started my undergraduate degree pursuing aerospace engineering at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University in Daytona Beach, Florida with Rachel. And it was infinitely harder than I ever thought it would be. My first semester pretty much put me in shock. I was not getting the same straight A's that I used to be in high school. I was getting really anxious and things just felt like they were falling apart. And it wasn't until my second semester that things started to click and make a little bit more sense. I failed out of my physics 3 class. I had to get the dean of the physical sciences department to pretty much sign a paper that certified me as like stupid. And then when I went to get him to sign it, he just verified all of my self-doubt by telling me that if I couldn't pass this one little physics class, there was no way I'd ever be able to become an engineer. And then those events were quickly followed by a failing grade on a statics exam, except that professor handled things a little differently. He asked me to come visit during office hours, and he had me redo all of the exam questions with slight changes. And when I got them all right, he asked me if I had test anxiety. mental illness wasn't exactly a big conversation we had with my family growing up. So when he asked, I could just feel my stomach tighten and I was mortified. I thought that mental illness was something that just crazy people had, not a 20-year-old college freshman at the time. But he invited me to check out my school's counseling center, and so I did. They helped me find local mental health professionals that could give me a real diagnosis and help me cope with all of it. But this was only freshman year. I still had 3 years left, and honestly, they weren't much easier. I had some really great professors and friends, and I had some really bad ones. And some semesters, the bad outweighed the good. I ended up being hospitalized for my mental health more than once during my time in college, and even had to drop out for a semester to go home and focus on getting better. However, I promise you, as you can see from the picture on this slide, my college story had a happy ending. In my last semester, I ended up landing an internship at NASA's Kennedy Space Center as a modeling and simulation intern. I worked on testing flight controller scripts for the Orion capsule and even got to do some hands-on research, developing dual quaternion-based algorithms for future touch-and-go asteroid landing missions flight software. And then after all that, my internship reminded me of all the reasons why space is where I truly belong, kind of replenished all of that bad energy that I got from those first 2 years. And I successfully graduated with my bachelor's degree in aerospace engineering in May of 2018. And so that all really leads me to where I am now. I'm a space mission analyst at L3 Harris Technologies. I play one of the most important roles in our small satellite development. I'm the girl that plots the orbits, like you can see on these slides, calculates the orbital dynamics experienced by the satellite, and tells my team whether or not their crazy spacecraft design ideas will actually work once the satellite's in space. And you'd be really surprised how often I get to tell my much older male coworkers that their designs won't actually hold up once they're in space. I love my job though, because I love the idea of exploring brand new things while still being able to think analytically. I have to understand how every component and subsystem of the satellite works together, and then I have to understand what the space environment's impact on each of those will be so I can make sure that we successfully perform our mission. Some days my job is just a whole day of coding components for our satellite flight software, and other days it involves a more visual form of analysis like you can see in the pictures on the slide. So I get to use both sides of my brain, the math and logic for planning and scheduling and analysis of the satellite's mission performance, and then the creative side, which helps me come up with unique solutions to various problems my coworkers come to me with. And all of that, plus my experiences as a woman in STEM, led me to starting Reinvented, Inc. in 2019. I wanted to give girls like me the support I wish I had going through all those obstacles and show them that there were so many professional women in STEM out there doing the things our readers aspire to do one day themselves. As a female aerospace engineer, I really could care less at the time about how hot Justin Bieber was, but I cared a lot about things like the all-female spacewalk. And so that's exactly what Reinvented Inc. does. We provide our younger readers with role models, and we give them a place where they can see themselves in the stories we tell and relate. Our mission is to empower and inspire the next generation of girls to pursue their interests in STEM. We do that first by providing them with role models. By showing our readers that scientists and engineers look like them, they feel like they can do it too. Our magazine also gives them insight into what STEM careers look like. Many of our articles talk about the day in the life of an engineer, and that helps spark their curiosity. And then finally, we provide them with the opportunity for hands-on experience, whether it's through our DIY section or our upcoming Princesses with Power Tools program. We give our readers the opportunity to get hands-on with STEM. Over the last 2 years, our small magazine has grown into an unstoppable force for change. We've delivered magazines to over 12,000 readers all over the world. We've donated over 5,000 magazines through our One for One program, which we'll talk about a little bit later. And we reached a huge milestone for us last year, which is really exciting for everyone, when we got Wyoming, which was our last state. But we now have readers in all 50 states and well over 25 different countries. Every issue includes a cover story, like you can kind of see some of our covers here, of a more notable woman in STEM. In the past, we've featured the former CTO of the United States, Megan Smith, founder of Adafruit, Lamar Fried, Raven the Science Maven, who's definitely been one of my personal favorites, If Then Ambassador, Maria Perez, and so many more. In addition to the cover story, we make sure at least one article specifically focuses on diversity and inclusion topics, such as respecting pronouns, dealing with imposter syndrome, and creating things like accessible tech. Our Everyday Changemaker series is where we highlight the stories of 4 or 5 everyday women in STEM. So far, some of my favorites have been a ballerina who's also a quantum physicist and maybe a future astronaut, and I think is going to be on America's Got Talent this year. Food scientists, Miss America, who did elephant toothpaste as her kind of big exhibit or talent for, you know, winning Miss America, and so much more in the past. This section is where we really let the experiences of women in STEM shine. We always ask our everyday change makers to give their advice to our readers on, you know, what helped them get to where they are today and how our readers can do something similar. We also make sure we talk about general STEM topics. So one of my favorites is when we got to get a behind the scenes look at the making of Star Wars. We interviewed some of the female animators who worked on the latest Star Wars movie, and they showed us how the tech that they built is what actually makes the Star Wars movies look as cool as they do. We've also done some exclusive coverage of rocket launches, intros to things like 3D printing or soldering, and how to get started in science communication. Finally, we wrap up each issue with a DIY feature where we provide a step-by-step tutorial on how to do a STEM project. Our next issue will feature a smart mirror tutorial, but past issues have included tutorials on things like LED greeting cards, light-up bracelets, or making moon craters. Finally, I want to leave you all with a really great way to get involved with our programs and our magazine. I think the number one way is to become part of our one-for-one program that I mentioned a little bit earlier. It's my absolute favorite part of our organization, and it's run by the one and only Aly, so I will let her go ahead and talk a little bit more about it.
Thanks, Caeley. So as COO, one of the most important programs that we have is the one-for-one program. Reinvented Magazine wants to ensure that we have accessible content, whether in a low-income community or a rural area who may not have access to a computer. So how we do that is a one-for-one program. For every magazine that's purchased, up to one is donated to a Title I school, nonprofit, or other nonprofit program, or any sort of STEM groups. So we highly encourage that you sign up for the one-for-one program. Our issue 9 one-for-one program is open. I think our contact information is at the end of this PowerPoint, so feel free to reach out if that's something you're interested in.
Yes, Aly, you are absolutely right. Our contact information is on this last slide here, so definitely feel free to copy all this down, stay in touch. We'd love to keep talking to you guys about Reinvented Magazine, and do not hesitate to reach out to Aly about joining our one-for-one program. But I think we have some time left over for questions, so ask away.
All right, thank you so much, all three of you. I love Reinvented Magazine. I've told you that a bunch of times. I think the first question that I have is, what is your advice for women and girls going into these often male-dominated career fields? Aly, would you want to go first?
Sure. Really just don't be afraid to stick up for yourself. I mean, you need to be your own advocate, and if something is not right, or you see something, you know, don't be afraid to speak up for yourself. Reach out to either another colleague or teammate or something like that to be support through it.
Yeah, absolutely. Rachel, would you have anything to share?
Yeah, sorry. One thing that I think is good advice is just don't be afraid to keep going. Don't never give up. If you don't succeed at something at first, don't think that just because you don't succeed, you can't do it. It's all about, you know, practicing what your craft is and repetition and making sure that you become an expert. So just don't give up, because I think if we did give up, all three of us, we probably wouldn't be where we are today.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that it is that don't give up statement that you're saying is really prevalent in all of your stories. So thank you for also being that kind of a role model. Caeley, what about you? Any advice?
So I think one, don't be afraid to ask for help. I think there are a million and one communities of women in STEM out there, and I've never, ever seen a single woman in STEM like say no when someone has asked for help, like we're here and we want to help you and advocate for you. So don't be afraid to use us. And I think number two is there's, you know, always this huge misconception that to be a woman in STEM, you have to kind of conform to what the stereotypical woman in STEM is. And so I always like to encourage everyone that you don't need to change any part of who you are in order to fit in this field. It may seem differently sometimes, but to go along with what Rachel and Aly said, just, you know, don't give up, you know, continue to find ways to be yourself no matter what.
Yeah, that's great. So what age range is the magazine for? Like what reading level?
So we aim for the high school reading level, but we can also send it to like early college students as well. But it's okay. Definitely mainly for high school.
Mainly high school. And just again, how much is a subscription?
So a print subscription is $28. So that gets you 4 print magazines sent to you every 3 months or quarterly. And then digital subscriptions are the same thing, but you get the subscription digitally via email, and that's $20. And then if money is an issue, cost, or any other barrier, like we mentioned in one of our last slides, the one-for-one program exists pretty much to make sure that our magazines are getting to girls that need them regardless of their, you know, situation or status. So if you know someone who would love a magazine, or you know a teacher that would love one in their classroom, please do not hesitate to fill out that application for the one-for-one program. We'd love to send you some free magazines.
That is great. I love that. So I know you three aren't always the ones writing the articles, but as you featured a lot of women in STEM and in STEAM, what have been some of your favorites? Or what have been some of the even advice or things that have shared that was your favorite?
For me, I got to interview Alyssa Carson, which she's a 19-year-old that is trained to be the first woman or person on Mars. And it was great because I got to meet her in person and actually do that interview in person. And it was just crazy talking to a 19-year-old and seeing how much wisdom she had. She was so beyond her years, and I was able to write the article about her. And I just loved being able to share her journey with everyone about her training and everything like that.
What does training entail to be able to be one of the first people on Mars?
Well, she has been doing lots of like scuba diving, underwater, things like that. I follow her on Instagram, and she actually just did a 30-hour dive where she went underneath the water, and it was like 30 feet under, and she had to live in this habitat underwater for 30 hours, and she was completely by herself, and she just kind of, you know, dove down there, hung out, she slept there overnight, and then she just came back up. So I think she was able to get certified for that, for something that was probably relevant to, she said that it simulates the isolation that you would feel if you're in space. So I think that's why she did that.
Wow. Okay. Very cool. Aly, any favorites?
My favorite is recently we had now Dr. Raven, the science maven, on the cover of issue 8. And I knew she was a molecular biologist, but I didn't realize that her interest, her research was also like memory loss and aging. Mm-hmm. And I had no idea our projects were kind of in the same spectrum. So I thought that was really, really cool. I didn't get to meet her, interview her, but just seeing and her SciComm stuff. I love it. I'm so glad we were able to get her.
Yeah, that's being able to see someone like you in a career field also studying something that you're interested in. That's really encouraging. That's cool. Caeley, what about you?
I don't know if I have a favorite. Raven was definitely a really cool one. What I will say though is I think that everyone that we've interviewed has been pretty cool. And what's been really fun and exciting for me is pretty much with every feature or some of our interviews too. It's like, you know, it'd be really cool if we got Megan Smith on the cover, and then like, bam, we somehow made it happen. Or like, we'd love to have like Jen Goldbeck, because like all of us were a huge fan of the golden ratio, because I have a golden retriever service dog, so I follow her, and I was like, that would be cool. And I think seeing our team be able to like make all of these like dream interviews happen, and like actually having women that like I personally have looked up to for a while on our covers being able to share their stories has been like this huge dream come true for me. And I think that, you know, Raven was a big one, especially because I think everyone loved that she was also a rapper. So she was definitely one of the most fun. But all of the women have been incredible. So
yeah, absolutely. Caeley, I hear that there is an Easter egg in each of your Reinvented magazines. Would you share with what they should be looking out for?
Yeah, there is. I share my story at the beginning. My mom is such a huge reason why I am who I am today, not just like as an engineer, but as a person. And so I owe so much to her. And so when I started this magazine, you know, the first issue I hid in there the words, "Hi, Mom." And my mom found them. And I think in the second issue, we didn't put them in because we were like, this would be like a one-time thing. My mom got so upset, so sad. She was like, "Hey, I can't find it." I'm like, "It's not in there. It was just in the first issue." And so since then, every single issue after that, they're somewhere in the magazine. We have "Hi, Mom" hidden. To give you some like hints, we've had it like in graphics, like in the footer, like the page numbers, the table of contents. Like they're not always in super obvious places, but it's in every issue, I think, except issue 2.
Oh, I like that a lot. I think that's so cute. So how about some of like the feedback that you've gotten from Reinvented, or like just in general reviews? What have people said to you about it?
I'll let other people answer, but I think one of my favorites came out just after issue 1. So we had done our big like Women You Should Fund campaign, which is a crowdfunding campaign to, you know, launch our first issue. And shortly after it started mailing out, we had one mom who emailed us, and it was like not who we thought was going to be reading our magazine. She was really, really like the daughter was really young, but she told us that her kindergartner was like, she didn't know how to handle the situation. Her kindergartner was staying up late reading our magazine under her covers by like flashlight. And she didn't know whether or not she should scold her and tell her to go to sleep because it was past her bedtime, or let her keep reading. And she also pointed out that like, since she was in kindergarten, she really couldn't read too much of it, but she really loved seeing all the women dressed up as scientists and engineers on our pages. And like, that just like warmed my whole heart. Like it reminded me exactly why I was doing this. Even though, like I said, she wasn't exactly our target age range, I was so glad that like this magazine was in her hands, and I didn't really know what to tell mom. I was like, I think you should just keep letting her read it. But that was that, to this day, I think that is one of the pieces of feedback or the notes that we've gotten from a reader or parent that has stayed with me.
Very cool. I love the whole, I don't know if I should be letting her stay up. That's awesome. Rachel, Aly, do you have any experience with feedback or reviews?
My experience would be just like through the One for One program. I was the director of that for a little while, and just like getting the feedback from teachers and how much they love having that. Like, I know one of my friends is a teacher, and she gives it out to her students as part of their like science club stuff that they do. And I just think that's really cool that they have something, because it's something I wish I could have had when I was younger.
Yeah, I think that One for One program is really amazing. And I think it also has probably had people subscribe more often because it's reaching more people. So that's awesome. Rachel, did you have any feedback things or situations you were in where you got to hear about, or maybe even hearing from people you've interviewed?
Well, I was going to say my mom is a teacher, a fifth grade teacher, and she's always making me come over and do presentations to her class. And I did one presentation where we all gave everyone a copy of the Alyssa Carson issue 4, and they loved it. These little girls, they were like, "Oh my God," even though they were just in fifth grade, they were so excited just to see a girl dressed as an astronaut on a cover of a magazine. And so I always hear about that. And then also everyone at my mom's school, they always get the Princesses with Power Tools calendar. they love that. So I've always heard very positive feedback, and it's just very feedback from people close to home to me. So it's just nice that I have that support.
Yeah, that is fantastic. And it's a great magazine to support, so it makes it easy. So I was on Clubhouse, that like new podcasty live app, and all of a sudden I hear Caeley Looney's voice. And Caeley, can you talk about what occurred during that Clubhouse fundraiser, I guess?
Yeah, so I haven't been on Clubhouse in a little while, but I love Clubhouse. It takes a little bit to like find your niche and like find rooms that are meaningful to you. I will say that, but I think we found one. It's called Pitcher Nonprofit Show. They host it every Thursday at, I think, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard, 6 Central. And so what they do is it's like Shark Tank, but for nonprofits. So they have guest sharks that are all kind of big names in the nonprofit industry, or you are running successful businesses and like donating to nonprofits. And they have you come up on the Clubhouse stage, which, again, it's just a voice app, so it takes a little bit of that fear away. And you pitch your nonprofit. And so we, after issue 5, we had a ton of leftover copies of that issue. And we've been trying to send them out, but we haven't had the funding to actually ship and distribute them. We've had people who wanted them, a huge waiting list. So we went on Pitch Your Nonprofit and we asked for $2,000 so that we could ship out 1,000 magazines to girls like within those communities that we target with the 1-for-1 program. And I was horrified because I was the first one to go up on stage. I've been watching the show for a while and I'd never seen the first person to go up, get money. But we got the full $2,000. And since then we've been able to fundraise quite a bit more. I think we've almost raised about $5,000 total to distribute about 5,000 print magazines. And to date, we've distributed almost half of those 2,500 print copies of issue 5, which is our maker issue, thanks to kind of like that funding from Pitcher Nonprofit that kickstarted it, to girls mainly at Title I schools and low-income areas or places without Wi-Fi. And want to give a big shout out to the National Girls Collaborative, because they've been the one that's been helping us get connected with girls in those communities. But yeah, it was incredible. And I don't know if I'd ever go up on like Shark Tank, but it was a really like fun experience being able to like pitch and like actually win money for something that I'm passionate about. So
yeah, you did a great job, because I got to hear it. I thought it was great, and I was so happy for you when I started hearing the funding coming in. So that was fantastic. I mean, again, you've hearing some of the reviews about Reinvented and what it's doing for young girls, so it's a good thing for people to invest in. And speaking about National Girls Collaborative Project, that is a wonderful mentorship program. So if you have students that you're looking to connect with, people that look like them, that are like them, that are in these computing careers that students are expressing some interest in, explore National Girls Collaborative Project and connect them with some of those mentors. All three of you talked about difficulties in the transition from secondary education to post-secondary education. What could you have used from your high school teachers, school counselors, administrators, as far as encouragement or preparation for that moving on to post-secondary success? Rachel, would you want to go first?
I think one thing that's really important for educators just to keep in mind is that everyone is a different kind of learner. I'm a visual learner. Some people learn by hearing things or reading things. So I know for me, like, you could give me something written down on paper, but I won't fully understand it until I have a visual interpretation of it. So I think like educators, they can just make sure that when they're delivering information, make sure that you're doing it in a variety of ways to make sure that everyone is understanding it fully. Just because I think sometimes we don't reach all the different, you know, methods of learning. And I think that sometimes students feel left out when they're not learning the way that they are supposed to.
Yeah, absolutely. Aly, would you want to go next?
Sure. I would say, like, don't be afraid to think outside the box, because for one of my education classes, when I thought I was on the path to be a teacher, I wrote a whole lesson plan about the animal cell and plant cell, but creating it in Minecraft and then allowing students to like play Minecraft, but learn about the animal plant cell. So really like just coming up with really creative ideas that can pique their interest, I think would be awesome.
Yeah, absolutely. Just like and engaging in that conversation to mm-hmm. start understanding, you know, maybe what some of the fears are even for going on to college or outside of secondary education. Mm-hmm. But like those interesting ways of getting them to.
And I think you'd be surprised to how receptive like students will be to those kind of ideas. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Caeley, would you have anything to add?
You say the question one more time.
Yeah, we're just talking about all three of you had that similar difficulty in transition sort of with secondary to post-secondary success. So just knowing what would be some of the tips or maybe things that you could have used from your educators in high school to get you ready for that or prepared.
Sure. So I think I would probably want two things. One, I wish I learned how to study on my own without influence from teachers or parents. In college, there's way less handholding, way less reminders that you have a test coming up and it's important that you study. And I think that there's the shell shock of, well, if I didn't really have to study in high school, I probably won't have to study in college. And that's like absolutely not the case. So I wish I had a little bit more preparation there. And two, I talk about this a little bit in the video, but you know, my freshman year, I found out I had test anxiety. And when I look back on, you know, my experiences in high school, I remember pretty much before every single exam, I would get so sick, I would have to either go home in the middle of the day or I just would be too sick to go to school. I remember feeling more comfortable taking an exam, you know, in a separate space on like the makeup days. And I wish that was something that my teachers or my parents or someone while I was in high school identified, so I didn't have to struggle so much through, you know, my first semester and a half at college until professor there identified it somehow. So those would be my two things, I think.
Yeah, I really like those. And it kind of goes on with Aly said, like engaging the conversation in interesting ways to be able to find out what the students need. I'm going to switch gears just a little bit. Caeley, would you mind talking a little bit more about just that initial idea of Reinvented magazine and then how it came to fruition?
Sure. So I had just graduated college. I was officially an aerospace engineer, just started my first full-time job. And at the time I was still receiving 17 magazine, which is kind of your typical teens fashion magazine. For those of you who don't know what it is, it features a lot of like fashion, style, makeup, celebrity stories, all that kind of stuff. And is definitely geared towards that high school audience and college, I guess, 17 year olds. Makes sense. And so at the time, you know, I think this was one of my last issues, so I don't remember getting any after this. But I didn't really want to read any of it. I wasn't really interested. I think the issue had like the top 10 hottest male celebs from the summer, and I was just not into it. And so I went to the NCUIT Facebook group, which is where I often do when I have a complaint about most life things. Everyone in there is so nice and supports all of my complaints. And I was like, why doesn't a magazine for girls like us exist? And I pretty much turned my phone off, went to bed, and woke up the next morning to a Discord server that had already been started, like hundreds of comments and like reactions on this post of girls who were just like, yeah, why doesn't something like this exist? And so I think while Reinvented certainly started as something that was a little bit more selfish, a magazine that I personally wanted to be able to read on self-care days and things like that, I think it turned into something much bigger than me. It's geared now towards high school students and early college students, so not exactly my age range, but I think that it's getting the role models out there. It's, you know, enabling us to share stories and really amplify those stories so girls can see that there are women in STEM that exist. They're not just seeing your typical models on a front cover. You're seeing scientists and engineers who are rappers like Raven the Science Maven, and we're pretty much showing girls that, you know, scientists and engineers comes in all shapes, sizes, colors, and do whatever they want to be doing. So yeah, that's a little bit of how we got where we are now.
Yeah, I really enjoy it. I like how you said reading on self-care days. I enjoyed that. Because I agree, it's great reading on self-care days. So you can get like individual subscriptions just mailed to your house. Is Reinvented an appropriate thing to have like in media centers or like in school libraries?
Yeah, absolutely. I think having it in schools, one, there's a lot of benefits there. I mean, one, you're reaching a ton of students with just a couple copies of the magazine. Two, you're putting it alongside other magazines where you're now normalizing, again, women in STEM in the media, that this is just something that you can pick up and read at school, which is not something I've seen before. It was certainly not something I had at my school. So
it's a great thing. And then, of course, Rachel or Aly, if you wanted to just one more time talk about that one-for-one program for schools to be able to have Reinvented.
Yeah, I mean, I just want to interject real quick, though. One of our longest one-for-one partners is like local libraries. So absolutely, we have librarians request and teachers. So anyone who's interested, please apply. I think the link is in the chat. But our one-for-one program, basically any magazine that for every magazine that is purchased, one is donated to a girl in need, whether Title I school, low-income community, women in STEM groups, anything like that. We encourage you to apply for our program.
Very cool. I really like that one-for-one program. So how much is a subscription to Reinvented for a student?
So our print subscriptions are $28, and that gets you 4 issues over the course of a year, so one every 3 months. Our digital subscriptions are $20 for the same thing, except you just get it as a link in an email. You can view it online or download it as a PDF, again, once a quarter. We also sell like single issues if that's what you prefer. Like if you really like the person on the cover for like issue 9, you can just buy issue 9 instead of ordering a subscription. And that's $8.50 for print or $5.50 for digital. And then again, I just want to push the one-for-one program. We don't want costs to be a barrier. Like we want to make sure that your students are reading this magazine because these role models are so important. I love reading, you know, the stories of everyone in our magazine. So if you know you can't afford it, if you know cost is an issue, if you have students who want this to go to their own homes, like please have them fill out the one-for-one form. We want to give them free magazines.
I really like that. And what's the like reading level for the magazine?
Definitely high school and a little bit into early college, like during those transition years, but mostly high school.
Okay. Mostly high school, perfect. And that one-for-one program, we have it in the chat. What are some of your favorite articles or even maybe favorite issues, if you pick one? Who wants to go first? Aly, you want to go first?
I'll go first, yeah. Okay. So my favorite is Dr. Raven, the science maven, who is our issue 8 cover girl. I knew who she was, but I didn't realize that her research was also similar interests as mine, which is memory loss and aging. And I just thought that was so cool. And because I love her content, any of her SciComm videos and her raps, like they're just incredible. So I was so happy we got to have her.
Very cool. Yeah, she does sound really cool. Rachel, do you want to go?
Yeah, so my favorite issue is issue 4, because I got to interview Alyssa Carson, who is a 19-year-old that is training to become the first person to go to Mars. Mm-hmm. I got to meet her and interview her in person because she actually goes to school nearby, local to Melbourne, Florida. And she is so wise beyond her years. And she told me a little bit about her training, about how she's been scuba diving. She recently just did a dive where she had to go 30 feet into the water, and also she had to live down there for over 24 hours. So she became an aquanaut, is what they call it. And she said that she did that training because she wanted to feel the isolation of what it'd be like in space. So I guess that was a simulation of what she would actually experience if she went on a Mars mission.
So she went down there, she would be down there 24 hours a day for 30 days?
So she did one dive. Went down to like this little habitat, which was 30 feet under. And then she stayed down there for 24 hours, I think over 24 hours. And she slept down there and she was completely by herself the whole time. So is, I guess it'd be like being in a submarine, you know, just being isolated like that. And it was really cool. If you look her up on Instagram, Alyssa Carson, she had some pictures and she was able to see, you know, all the fish swimming by and like look out and look at, look into the ocean. So it was really cool.
Oh, that is really cool. That's really cool. Caeley, what about you?
I don't know if I have a favorite in particular. What I will say though is that every time we've had a feature or some of our issues, it's always been like, you know, it'd be really cool like having Megan Smith on the cover, and then we somehow managed to connect with her. Or it'd be really cool if we had Jen Goldbeck, who is like one of our like staff favorites, because she is like the dog mom of the golden ratio, and I have a golden retriever service dog, as you saw in my video. And so we all were like, it'd be great if we could get her. Or Raven was like a huge one. Like we had so many of our staff, like, you know, say like, it would be so cool if we had Raven. She has like 1,000,001 followers, and she's a rapper, and she has a PhD. And every single time we've been able to get some really awesome people on our cover. So it's been really exciting for me to be able to see women on our covers and in our magazine that like I have been personally looking up to as my role models for such a long time now. And I hope that we can continue to put those kinds of people on our covers.
Yeah, absolutely. Have there been any like articles that were really geared towards educational opportunities or like offerings, like course offerings? Has there been anything like that, or are you thinking about an article like that for the future?
So I don't know if we've done anything that's geared towards like a specific educational opportunity. In one of the issues, there is a series where we did like nonprofit features. So if you go look, we did like Project Invent, Girls Invent, and one other. So it was like three nonprofits. One was actually in Australia, I think, and we had two here in the US that we featured to kind of like show girls that there are opportunities to get involved within your local communities. But I think where the resources and opportunities really shine, we have an opportunities board at the end of every issue. We don't go into too much detail, but if you're looking for like upcoming events or like hackathons you can get involved with, conferences, you know, just like databases of like resources and stuff like that, we post all of that on the opportunities board.
That's, yeah, I like that. And you said that's right on the back usually?
Yeah. Let me see if I can find it. So it looks the same in just about every issue. It's right here. So we have the opportunities board. It literally looks like a little, like, you know, like a board with post-it notes. But each of these is like the Wonder Woman Tech Conference, all of our virtual events, Major League Hacking Summer Challenge, the Connectory, which is like a huge database run by National Girls Collaborative on finding local organizations and opportunities, and just a whole bunch more coming up within like that issue's time frame.
Very cool. So I received something while I was finishing my school counseling graduate program. So I was in my school counseling internship, and I was nominated and got this wonderful educator box. Could you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so last year we started this teacher care package program. Obviously we work a lot with students, but our magazine also goes out through a lot of educators. So we had quite a few educators reach out or kind of just express their general concerns about going back to school in the middle of a pandemic, trying to figure out how to do hybrid learning. So in-person curriculum and virtual curriculum all at the same time. We ultimately found out that a lot of teachers were pretty much sacrificing their own self-care to make sure their students had the best experience in school. And that like hurt our souls a little bit, because we want to make sure that our students are, or, you know, students reading our magazine or girls, you know, going into STEM, you know, have a teacher that like wants to be there and loves to be there. And a lot of teachers just were drained. So we put together these teacher care packages. Last year we sent out 203 of them because I couldn't turn off the form quick enough. And this year we're gonna do the same. So it contains a lot of like self-care items, a copy of our magazine, like hand sanitizer, face masks. I think we're gonna have like chapstick, things to put on your desk and stuff this year. And coffee, I just got everyone some coffee packs, which will be a cool addition this year. The nomination form opens on August 1st and then will close on August 31st or as soon as we get the 200 nominations. I'm expecting them to go pretty quick this year since I saw what happened last year. So make sure you're following Reinvented or signed up for our newsletter. Your counselors, anyone who works in a school is pretty much like qualified to get one. So please, please, please nominate yourself, nominate others. It was really cool. Teachers have been asking me all summer when they're coming back.
Oh, I love that. It was really nice to receive. It really was. So nominate your fellow educators. I think those are all the questions that we can take today. I want to thank you three all so much. This is a wonderful presentation. And yeah, I would like to encourage our attendees to visit our landing page and see some of the past recordings and webinars on our Advising for Future Ready Careers. We'll be starting a new series later this fall. So to receive updates about future webinars and programs from NCWIT C4C, you can fill out the link that is in the chat. And finally, look out for a survey in your email within the next few days to receive your $50 Amazon gift card and resource kit. And we thank you for your responses and for joining us. And we hope to see you in our next series this fall. Bye.